Good morning, one and all. Today's class, I'll be discussing with categories of research design, then different types of research design methods that are employed in any of the research activities that are followed today. Then, these experimental design methods are one of the important methods that can be employed to achieve minimum bias and maximum reliability with respect to any of the research activity that can be considered. It can be with the purpose of economy with respect to cost, time, and effort that is put in by any research activity. Here, the researcher can prove his ability in providing the apt information by gathering the data and analyzing the data in a better manner so as to provide accurate and precise solutions to any given research problem. Thus, with respect to the previous class, we discussed on basic principles of research design. Here, like principle of randomization, replication, and principle of local control, which are the utmost important principles that are provided by Professor Fisher so as to use it with these types of experimental design. Let me again list the few experimental design that can be used in any of the research problems or activity that will be taken into by the researcher. The experimental design can be categorized into two sections. One is informal design and formal design. In case of informal design, we have three more classifications. Informal experimental design. First one here is before and after without control design. After only with control design, then third year includes before and after with control design. Design, we can have completely randomized design, as we call it as PR design. Next, we can have randomized block design. We call it as RB design. Then Latin square design, which we term it as LS design. And factorial design. These are the classification with respect to research design wherein we employ the experimental design in case of formal experimental design, informal experimental design, and formal experimental design. So in the beginning, we will take up the first part, which includes informal experimental design, before and after without control design, after only with control design, and before and after with control design. This type of experimental design. Here, the Professor Fisher says that in such type of research experimental design, a design is considered as a single test group or area that is selected, and dependent variable is measured with respect to the method or introduction of treatment here. The treatment is then introduced and measured again with the treatment. The effect of treatment will be equal to the level of phenomena after the treatment minus the level of phenomena before the treatment. The overall explanation can be provided with the block diagram. Test area, if we consider, then level of phenomena before treatment, if we consider it as X, then, and with respect to this, if treatment is introduced, then we get certain results. Here we term it as level of phenomena after treatment. Thus, this can be termed as Y. For any research purpose, if a population of sample is taken, then if this is a treatment X that is provided to any of the problem statements, then we have to measure the phenomena before the treatment. Once the treatment is introduced, then measure the phenomena after the treatment. Thus, treatment effect will be Y minus X. For example, if an agriculturist takes a specific area, which we call it as a test area, he divides it into different levels, then he first checks the yield before any treatment of the fert or before any application of the fertilizer. Then he will apply the required amount of fertilizer to a certain piece of land. Then he will check the phenomena or the yield. Let us take an example of an yield. Then he will apply the treatment by providing proper fertilizer. Then, once the treatment is given, then he will check the yield and he'll measure in terms of treatment Y. So the yield after the treatment minus before the treatment will provide us the required treatment effect. Thus, this type of informal experimental design is one of the simplest, and it is considered in only single test area or a group. Then the dependent measure with respect to the fertilizer over the yield is considered onto a test area. Thus, this is one of the most used or sort of methods in the agricultural field because it is simple and no control over the experimentation or the treatment is provided. But what happens in such type of experimental design is, or the main difficulty here is, over the passage of time, there may be certain extraneous variable which is not controllable, and therefore it will affect the this value, that is treatment effect. Thus, one can go for the next type of experimental design under informal only with the controlled design. This method. So let me explain this method. Here also the test area is considered. Along with that, control area is also considered. Test area, then control area. Under the test area, the level of phenomena is considered where treatment is introduced. Then, in case of test area, if treatment is introduced, then level of phenomena after the treatment also need to be measured. Which we can term it as Y. Then in a control group, where we need to check the results, directly the level of phenomena is considered. And here level of phenomena without treatment where we can term it as Z. Thus we have test area, control area. For the test area the treatment is introduced and level of phenomena after the treatment will be considered. Hence, the treatment effect here will be Y minus Z. That is why we call the informal design with respect to after only with control design. So, if I consider a piece of land, then I divide it into test area and the control area. For the test area, the phenomenon after the treatment, the yield may be considered. Whereas under the control area, certain control factors are provided for that piece of land. Then the level of phenomena or yield is considered without the treatment. So this gives the treatment effect. The basic assumption here is, in the beginning, the two areas are identical with respect to the behavior of the phenomena. Then in this case, the treatment is provided only to the test area and not to the control area. The dependent variable is same in both the cases. So this can exhibit following data which can be considered for the solution or identifying the yield with respect to the test area and the control area. However, as the previous method, here also over the passage of time, there may be certain extraneous variable that would be occurring. But it is much more superior because the control area is also considered into the effect. The third experimental design is before and after with control design will provide a better understanding of the yield. That is the reason most of the time if it is an informal experimental design, then the test area as well as control area is provided with certain treatment and then the level of phenomena is being checked. So if it is a third case, then with respect to informal experimental design, then if this is a test area and control area, for a time period period 1, for a time period 1, level of phenomena it can be yield, it can be the productivity or so, before treatment is considered, which is X, whereas level of phenomena before treatment A, then for both the cases treatment is introduced, and then the results are being checked for a time period 2, where level of phenomena is considered after the treatment, or the yield is checked after the treatment. And here we consider it as Y, and for the control area also we consider it as Z. Hence, in this experimental design, there is a time passage for test area as well as control area. The treatment before is being considered, whereas for test area as well as control area, in the second phase of time, treatment is introduced and then the level of phenomenon is considered. Thus, the treatment effect will be Y minus X minus Z minus A. This is how we can assess the data with respect to before and after with control design. Here also one thing we need to remember, that under the test area as well as control area, both are identical, and dependent variable is measurable, and these designs are simple, and especially this design avoids certain extraneous variables resulting in both passage of time. Thus, we can go for either before and after with control design if we are employing experimental design with respect to informal design, or we can go for after only with control design. So this is an explanation with respect to informal experimental design. Now if we consider formal experimental design, then to begin with, let's take customized or completely randomized design. Formal design, experimental design, let us start with completely randomized design. We also call it as CR design. In this type of design, we handle basically two principles here. The one is replication as well as randomization. It provides a researcher to employ both the type of principles onto the experimental design. And it is simplest of all the methods, and the design analysis can be easier. For example, there are 10 subjects and a course of activity under statistics is taken. Then one can divide 5 subjects for test area and 5 subjects for control area. Hence, It provides the flexibility in understanding the problem statement, as well as provide a better design with respect to completely randomized design method. Then, here usually one-way analysis or two-way analysis can be employed, and it provides the degrees of opportunity to identify the different degrees of freedom here. And usually these type of experimental design can be taken with homogeneous activities. Thus, we can also use certain unequal replications that can also work. And here it provides maximum degrees of freedom with a limited error. Thus, when such designs are to be considered, a homogeneous activity will provide better solutions and will provide minimum bias and maximum reliability, as I said earlier. And generally, in this type of design, all types of uncontrollable or extraneous factors can be put under a heading of chance factors. This is what is required so as to provide an accurate and precise design, and further the analysis will be simpler. There are two variations in completely randomized design. Here, two groups, simple randomized design, or it is random replication design. Let us take one method here first in the beginning. Two group simple randomized design. Okay. We will take each of this at the end of the class with different examples. Here we need to remember that it includes both randomization and replication. That is principle of randomization and replication. In case of two group simple randomized design, then if any problem statement is considered, then we need to gather the data. From the data, certain population is considered for the study, wherein we employ an experimental design of formal type, which includes two group simple randomized design. Then, if a certain population is considered, then randomly select a sample. Population of 1000, randomly select a sample of 50. Random sample. Or with respect to that sample, it is put into a experimental design method. And this randomly assigned sample will go into a randomly assigned group. One is experimental group and the other is control group. And for each of these groups, the level of phenomena needs to be identified. And here level of phenomena can be considered as treatment A and treatment B. Okay? And treatment A and B will be affected with various independent variables. Let me explain again. To consider two groups simple randomized design, a certain population is considered for study, out of which a random sample is taken. That sample is provided or put into randomly assigned groups, where we term it as experimental group and control group. Each of these groups is provided with treatment A and B with respect to the different independent variables. Now, how does this two group simple randomized design work? Here, one thing that you have to remember is, if this has to work, then same population is to be considered for experimental group and control group, and each of these two groups are provided with different treatment. The merit of this method of design is, one is simple and it randomizes the difference between the two treatments that has been provided. The treatment will be special studies or casual usual studies, or the treatments can be certain regular subjects that needs to be considered and here special subjects, and independent variable will be the intelligence that can be understood with respect to the effect of different other variables. But the limitation is individual differences are not eliminated in this type of method. Thus, two treatments can have usual training, as I said, or specialized training, and each of these groups will have an process of rejecting the hypothesis as well. Thus, here what we need to do is the random sample that we collect will be, should, or the sample that we consider for study should be appropriate so that it is not affected with certain extraneous variables. Thus, with respect to this type of method, the extraneous variable or the differential effects of extraneous variables cannot be controlled. That is, principle of local control cannot be achieved with respect to this method. Thus, if we go for the next method, that is random replication design, then all these limitations can be eliminated. With respect to random replication design, under completely randomized design, the principles here employed are replication as well as randomization. Hence, the population considered here will change. If I consider the flow diagram for this method under completely randomized design, population available for the study and population as well here available for the study, random selection is done, here also random selection is done. As the name itself says, it is two way method. Okay, once the selection is done, consider a sample to be studied in both the situations. Each of these sample is given a random assignment. And in each of these random assignments, if we consider the assignment maybe like this, group 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, as well as here it is given E and here it is given C. E is experimental group. And C is control group. If we consider this example, then there are various independent variables that exist. Okay? With respect to independent variables, C is given treatment B and E is given treatment A. Population is taken in both the cases. Random assignment is given to group 1 experimental group with the treatment A. With reference to the independent variables, same random assignment is considered. Here, random assignment is given to experimental group and random assignment is given to C with treatment B. First, random assignment can be considered with an experimental group A and control group B in these cases. So the illustration here says that there is replication of the data and also there is randomization of the population. It serves various purposes. Basically, it controls the effects of extraneous variables as well as the difference between the two treatments or difference between the treatments that has been employed for experimental group and control group can also be analyzed. Thus, it becomes very clear that there are two populations with replication in a design. Hence, here one thing that we have to remember is if there are 8 individuals, then 8 individuals will also go through an experimental treatment A and B as well as control group with treatment A and B. So this becomes a replication randomization of the population. The extension of this type of method is also termed as randomized block design. Here one of the advantages is that, as I said, replication and randomization as well as differential effects of the extraneous variables between these two groups can be understood, or it can be identified, or I can say it can be minimized to certain extent. Then the next group here is, or the next type under formal design is randomized block design. After completely randomized design, CR design, we are taking the second one, randomized block design. This is one of the important experimental designs that are used by various research authors. Here, the principle of local control is also considered, and replication as well as randomization is used. It is an improvement over completely randomized design. And in this type of design, first, any problem statement that is given or any population of sample that is to be studied is considered. It is divided into two subjects or two groups, and each group will be termed as blocks, and within the group there can be homogeneous variable into it. For example, if we consider student A, B, C, D and E, he is allowed to go through different forms 1, 2, 3, 4 for a certain course of activity. Then he has to go through, each student has to go through the various forms, and based on their IQ level, if we obtain a data, then it will be of this manner. With a very low IQ, student A, form 1 he can score 82, 90, 86 and 93. Then low IQ with respect to a subject, form 1, 2, 3, 4, then he can score 67, 68, 73 and 77. Average student will score 57, 54, 51 and 60. High IQ student, if he attempts, then he can score 71, 70, 69, or a 65. E, very high IQ can score more than distinction. So this is a simple example or a statistic that can be understood, which is selected for 5 IQ blocks and following scores obtained for each of the students A, B, C, D with respect to form 1, 2, 3, 4. After attempting, these may be the scores. Thus, with respect to this, number of subject in each block should be same, and each block can be randomly assigned for a given treatment. Form 1 randomly assigned to low IQ, form 2 randomly assigned to very high IQ. Hence, there is homogeneous activity that takes place with respect to each of the blocks. In case of randomized block design, all levels hold certain extraneous variables and it is fixed. Thus, the total variability with respect to the principle of local control can be identified. And the main feature of this type of design is each treatment appears same number of times and in each block. This is one advantage. Form 1 for a student A, form 1 will appear B, C, D and E, equal number of times. And for a student A, he has to go through 1, 2, 3, 4. Again, for student B, he has to go through 1, 2, 3, 4. So it is equal number of treatments can be distributed. And if each student separately is randomized in order which he takes 4 tests with respect to 4 forms, then we refer this design experiment as randomized block design. And thus the purpose of this is to take care of possible extraneous variables that may exist in these type of activities. And here, randomized block design usually is provided with better analysis. And here also we can call it as two-way analysis of variance technique. This can also be called as on two-way ANOVA technique. As I said, most of the researchers may use this type of experimental design method. So this is how it will be fruitful with respect to conduction of the different experiments using this type of experimental design. Then we can go for the next one, that is Latin square design. Under Latin square design, the experimental design is frequently used in terms of agriculture where the conditions for agricultural investigation is required. Here, if 5 different varieties of fertilizers are used, then specific 5 test areas also to be considered. Here, the effect of this can be judged with 5 different types of crops. 5 different fertilizers, 5 different types of crops. Hence, it has to be almost equal, and under Latin square design, each treatment appears equal number of times. For example, if we need to consider X1, X2, X3, X4, XY as the seeds, varieties of seeds that is considered, and we are supposed to determine or use the fertility level with 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. For a given number of seeds, for a given fertility level, what may be the yield can be identified. The yield can be rated with A, B, C, D and so on. This is how we can obtain the results. Thus, in case of Latin square design, each field may be divided into so many blocks, and these blocks with different fertilizers, and it is either column wise or row wise. The merit of this type of experimental design will provide or will eliminate the comparison effect between the others. And thus, we must assume here that there is no what we can say is there is no interaction between the two treatments. Thus, by adjusting the results, we can obtain the yield with respect to the seed and the fertility level. But one limitation here is the rows and columns should be equal. So we can call the LS square design as 2x2, and usually 5x5 or 9x9 LS square designs are considered in most of the experimental design if it is a type of Latin square design. And if we go consider our treatment levels more than 9x9, then it will become more complicated and the rows and columns may not be homogeneous. Thus, it is suitable for the agricultural purposes to understand the various factors of yield or productivity with respect to the seed, soil content or fertility or any other matter. Okay, then in the next class I will be covering with factorial design, because we have simple factorial design, we have different methods here, 4x3 factorial design, 2x2 factorial design, complex factorial design. Thus, this part of information will be taken in the next class. So what is the summary of today's class? Summary of today's class here is the different experimental designs in case of formal and informal. Under formal, it becomes very simple, wherein we only apply treatments either to the test area or to the control area and check the level of phenomenon. But if we go for a formal experimental design, then each of the test area or a control area will be considered in terms of blocks. Each blocks are provided with a treatment. Either it is a completely randomized design, or it is a randomized block design, or it can be Latin square design, where the main objective here is to how do I eliminate the extraneous factors in terms and change or put into a category of chance variables. And moreover, randomized design, experimental design is used than others. And the Latin square design especially is put into a category of where the agricultural applications exist. Hence, these type of designs, if we employ in our research process, then each of these treatments will provide certain results. These results can be put into an analysis of variance technique, where uncontrollable factors can be minimized and the accurate results or reliable results can be obtained. Thus, it is a purview of a researcher who can use any of these experimental designs with the purpose of obtaining precise information. So, I'll be closing the chapter here. Next class, I'll be considering the factorial design into picture.